Although it is most common to perform frequency domain simulations in ADS, it is also possible to perform simulations in the time domain. Today, we'll use the Transient Simulation Controller to obtain results that are similar to that of SPICE simulations. It is important to note that transient analysis is performed entirely in the time domain, so it is unable to account for the frequency-dependent behavior of elements such as microstrips and as parameters. We have to represent elements with simplified, frequency-independent models, but these simplifications are usually very reasonable at low frequencies. Today, we'll simulate a simple capacitor charging circuit. Implementing a time-based switch can be tricky in ADS. We'll look at two ways to implement the switch. The easiest way to implement a single switch is with the voltage step function. Go to the source's time domain palette and place the component. We'll leave the delay at 0 nanoseconds and set the rise to 0 nanoseconds. Now we'll place the resistor and capacitor from the schematic. Although this is an extremely unrealistic situation, we are essentially combining the switch and the voltage source to connect the voltage to the capacitor at t equals 0. Changing the delay is essentially the same as changing which time the switch is flipped. Let's measure the current and the voltage of the capacitor. We'll switch to the probe components palette and place a current probe. We'll use a label to measure the voltage. Now we add connections to the circuit. As always, we need a simulation controller. The transient controller is under the simulation transient palette. Place the controller. We'll leave the stop time to 100 nanoseconds and make the step size 1 nanosecond. I'll simulate. Now I'll add plots of the current and voltage. Because we performed a transient simulation, the x-axis will automatically be set to time rather than frequency. Note that we can see the capacitor charge over time. It is possible to do a voltage switch implementation of the time switch, but there are a few extra steps that we need to take. Instead of using one switch, we'll have to use two switches to create a shunt. This way, we can make sure that the initial voltage over the capacitor is set to zero. I've set up a DC voltage source, capacitor, current probe, and controller in advance. Now we need a voltage-controlled switch. This can be found under the system switch and algorithmic palette. We don't need a model name since we're setting the values on the component itself. We'll set R1 to 100 mega ohm and R2 to 50 ohm. This means when the voltage over the 3 and 4 pins is 0 or less, the switch will have a huge amount of resistance, and at voltages of 1 or more, it will have 50 ohms. Let's put a label VCon over the 3 pin so we can set up the measurement for the input into the switch. We now need a voltage step to activate the switch. We'll place the step function on the 3 pin and connect the 4 pin to ground. This means the voltage across the switch will be the output of the step function. Now we copy-paste the switch and rotate. We have to switch the resistor values around. Let's pause briefly to discuss what's happening. We need two switches because the voltage switch essentially acts as a resistor. The voltage into the switch controls which resistance value is being used. Before the step, the switch between the source and the capacitor will face nearly infinite resistance. If I have only one switch, the initial state for the voltage across the capacitor will be 1 because the DC source is outputting 1 volt. Therefore, we need to force the initial condition of the capacitor to be zero. We can do this by creating another switch controlled by the same step function. Note that the labels will be the same voltage at the same time. Before the step in the step function, the switch connects the capacitor to ground, making it have no charge. As soon as the step occurs, however, the switch to the voltage source will become a resistor, while the switch to ground becomes essentially open. Now that we understand what's happening, we simulate. I've set up current and voltage plots in advance. We see here that the current and voltage are responding as we would expect for a charging capacitor. Although the second method requires more components, it may be necessary when you're implementing multiple time switches. As always, the choices you make will be based on the circuit that you're trying to model. Thank you for watching this Keysight ESOF EDA tutorial. You can find a link to a free trial of ADS in the video description below.